Good evening, everyone. I'm Vara Prasad, Senior Lecturer of Food and Beverage Service, working with Shakti College of Hotel Management, Hyderabad. Today, I'm accompanied with Mr. Gopi Krishna. He is also working as Senior Faculty in the same college. In this presentation, we will discuss about introduction to hospitality industry, scope and career opportunities in the same field. And also, we'll look into beverages part, that is non-alcoholic beverages, alcoholic beverages classification, a small information about wine classification, and as well how to read a wine label, that is understanding a wine label, will also be discussed in this presentation. Coming to the point, hospitality industry, scope and career opportunities. Hospitality industry is considered as one of the fastest growing industry in terms of numbers employed worldwide. According to United Nations World Tourism Organization, hospitality industry and tourism sector, they have recorded a growth rate of 4.625% in the last 5 years. In fact, this is the second largest industry in terms of revenue generating and as well as employment next to oil and crude industry. Nevertheless, India is also making a good amount of revenue in tourism industry. As per the statistics, the central government has projected a growth rate of 9%. It has projected a growth rate of 9% in the present decade, in fact. But last year, in 2013, according to Ministry of Tourism, Government of India, we generated a revenue increase of 14% when compared to 2012. Year. So, and of course, through tourism industry and hospitality, we earn a lot of foreign exchange. This foreign exchange can be used to clear the balance of payments. And even the revenue generated in the tourism industry and hospitality industry will be contributed to the GDP of the country. Realizing this factor, contribution to the GDP and as well as foreign exchange can be used for clearance of balance of payments. The central government has made the hospitality industry as one of the highest priority sector. In fact, the central government has allowed 100% FDI, foreign direct investment, as you all know. So they allowed 100% FDI in hospitality and tourism sector. In India, nowadays, medical tourism, spiritual tourism in the sense of Buddhist tourist circuits, developing Buddhist tourist circuits, Hindu tourist circuits, this is more gaining more popularity. And even sports tourism is also gaining popularity. We talk about IPL, IBL. These leagues are in fact attracting more of domestic tourists and as well as foreign tourists also, even players are also coming, and the hospitality revenue is increasing year by year because of sports tourism. Even now, the tier 2 and tier 3 cities are coming with more number of star hotels, but we can't even imagine this kind of hospitality growth or hotels growth demand for hotel industry in the last 10 to 15 years, but nowadays it is happening. The hotels, international chains are coming to tier 2 and tier 3 cities. And as per the Ministry of Tourism data, that is the records what they maintain, we require 4,46,000 beds by year of 2015. In fact, we had only 2,29,000 beds, hotel beds, in fact, I mean to say. So these beds were there in 2011. But by 2015, we require 4,46,000. So it means that almost 100% growth. So do we have supporting manpower to engage this 4,40,000 beds? We have to generate that amount of manpower in the forthcoming years, in fact. Hospitality and hotel and hospitality and tourism sector has a lot of scope in the coming years. After studying hotel management, maybe it is a graduate, otherwise a craft core person need not to look into only star hotels for their jobs. They can also think about fast food joints. It is like KFC, McDonald's. Nowadays they are recruiting hotel management graduates to work in their joints as outlet managers, otherwise giving training to their lower level people. Even hospital catering also is one of the brightest, having a brightest career in the forthcoming years. Why? Because nowadays hospitals are like five-star hotels. They do provide catering to patients and as well as doctors. To handle this catering in the hospitals, The hospitals recruit food and beverage managers, executive chefs, and it's accommodation managers also. One can find jobs in institutional catering also. In the institutional catering, nowadays universities and international schools are coming up with guest houses, and as well as those the students' hostels also have to be managed. So to manage those guest rooms and the student hostels, we require somebody who is expert in hotel industry. And when it comes to industrial catering, yes, of course, as you all know, BHL, Telco, Tisco, these are all companies run their canteens. To manage those canteens in such a big scale, they are recruiting people from hotel management colleges. Experienced people they are recruiting. Cruise liners. You all must have heard about this. It is passenger ships. So they are like five-star hotels on the sea. They do recruit people from hotel industry. When it comes to railways, yes, in the railway catering also, IRCTC and their affiliated organizations who are taking care of catering in railways, they are recruiting people from hotel management colleges. In fact, when it comes to airline catering, the much talk about air hostess and as well as flight stewards, ground staff members, they are taken from hospitality and tourism industry. In fact, this airline catering has a further growth, good growth in the coming years as India is coming at more number of airlines and all. Then convention management. So in this also one can find jobs pertaining to F&B service. Event management, nowadays many of the event management companies recruiting people from hotel management to handle the events. As they are well versed with, as the students are well versed with how to handle the events. MNC companies, they are also having service apartments nowadays, and as well as they are providing catering to their employees to manage those outlets. So they are recruiting people from hotel management section. The hotel management graduates also can find jobs in state tourism development corporations and as well as Indian Tourism Development Corporation. Nowadays, every state tourism development corporation is constructing hotels in pilgrim places, and they are recruiting people from hotel management background. One can find jobs also in bartending. As a freelancer, they can work for many bars. Otherwise, they can design bars, in fact, for star hotels. Otherwise, they can conduct events, bar events, as a private one. One can find jobs in Indian Army and as well as Navy. In fact, Indian Army has a hotel management school in Bangalore. So they are training people in hotel management, 3 years degree they are offering. After that, they are recruiting the same people into Indian Army and as well as Navy to take care of the Army Armed Forces catering. Apart from all this, one can find a job in a hotel management institute also. After graduating from a university or a NCHMCT college, they can do a master degree in hotel management, and after that they can settle down as a faculty in hotel management colleges. And of course, food journalism and food styling, it is a gaining trend in the current world. Food journalism is something like writing reviews on the restaurant operations, and as well as a person visits the restaurant, he dines there, and he writes a review about his experience in the restaurant, and as well about the menu, food quality, presentation and all. So that these reviews will come up in magazines and as well as newspapers. One can start his career as a food stylist also. It is related to food photography, food presentation and food designing. Nowadays, if you find hoardings in your cities about promoting about the restaurants, they display some kind of presentation of food platters and all. So who designed this, who takes a shot of this? These food stylists, they are well experienced presenting these plates and as well as shooting the plates and publishing it. Of course, if you are worthy enough and as well as interested to start your own employment, that is start a hotel, otherwise a restaurant, you can also do that. It is purely your depends on your entrepreneurial skills. And now we discuss about beverages. Beverages are portable liquids. All liquids are not beverages. I mean to say portable here means drinkable. The drinkable liquids are called as beverages. Beverages are divided into two. One is a non-alcoholic beverage, other one is an alcoholic beverage. In the non-alcoholic beverage, the definition is, it is a beverage that contains alcohol less than 0.5%. A beverage that contains an alcohol less than 0.5%, that kind of beverage is called as non-alcoholic beverage. For example, like we talk tea, coffee, hot chocolate, milk. And if the alcoholic percentage is more than 0.5%, then that beverage is known as alcoholic beverage. So let us now look into the next slide, which talks about classification of non-alcoholic beverages. Non-alcoholic beverages are classified into three segments: stimulating, refreshing, and nourishing. They are divided into three segments, that is stimulating, refreshing, and nourishing. Stimulating beverages are these beverages that increase your nervous activity in the body of any biological system. That means they increase the heartbeat, they increase the blood pressure, so that one would be able to, he feels like he gains an energy and he will be able to increase his productivity. I mean to say, here this stimulating beverages, they increase the productivity. I mean to say here, just they are because of the elements that they are stimulating elements that they find in stimulating beverages. For example, in the tea, the stimulating element is theine. In the coffee, the stimulating element is caffeine. And cocoa also, that is hot chocolate, as you all know. Hot chocolate is cocoa. So in that also there is a caffeine. These are the stimulating elements, caffeine and as well as theine. These are the main responsible for the increasing blood pressure or heartbeat. So that a person feels like after consuming these beverages, a person feels like his productivity is increased. We all observe, once after working for long hours, we tend to have tea coffee, and after drinking tea coffee, we feel that we got some energy. But this energy is because of this stimulants like theine and caffeine. The next point is refreshing beverages. In the refreshing beverages, a beverage that replenishes fluid loss in the body after long working hours. See, in this here, a person gets sweat after working for long working hours. That means perspiration is there. In the sweat, we lose fluid. So that has to be replenished. If that fluid loss is not replenished, a person feels that he is tired and he will not be able to work anymore. If some beverage replenishes that, if somebody gets his fluid loss replenished. Automatically his body is chilled and that fluid loss will be coming to normal stage, and he feels that he has gained some energy and he feels that he can work for little further. Examples are refreshing beverages or water, aerated water, that is soda water in fact, soft drinks, ginger ale, tonic water, syrups, cordials and squashes. After a long working hour, we tend to drink chilled water. After drinking chilled water, we feel that our body is refreshed and we start working again. After drinking a thumbs up, a Coke, a Sprite, we feel that our energy is gained back and we start working again. But is this beverage giving any energy to your body? No, it is not giving any fresh energy to your body. It is just replenishing whatever the fluid loss has happened in your body, so that your body gets refreshed and then you feel like, yes, I gained some energy and you start working further. Here, I want to make a point here. What is ginger ale? It is a carbonated water that is flavored with ginger. Tonic water. It is also a carbonated water that is flavored with quinine. You all must have heard about this quinine. It is a medicine that is used in curing of malaria disease. That quinine is used, the quinine material is used and fortified to still carbonated water, that is sparkling water. Syrups, cordials and squashes, you all know these are fruit extracts used in some or other form in cocktail making, mocktail making, and these squashes also can be used along with the carbonated water or fresh water as a refreshing beverage. Nourishing beverages. The third one in the non-alcoholic beverages is nourishing beverages. Nourishing beverages, these are the beverages that really provide energy to your body. These are the beverages that provide energy supplements, that is nutrients to your body. For example, nourishing beverages are fruit juices, mocktails, smoothies and malted drinks. All the milk and the milk-based beverages come under this nourishing category. Unlike refreshing and stimulating beverages, this nourishing beverages provide energy to your body. In case of stimulating and refreshing beverages, they don't provide any energy to your body. Only nourishing beverages provide energy to your body. In the fruit juice category, all kinds of fruit juices provide energy. A person can live without a nourishing beverages without having food for some time. But in case of stimulating and refreshing, they cannot do that. That is why these are the very important beverages and person can live on this. That is why they are called as nourishing beverages. You all can see this. Mocktails. Mocktails, as you all know, it is a combination, a mix of two or more non-alcoholic beverages, mainly fruit juices. Malted drinks. These are like Milo, Complan, Bonvita, Horlicks, Ovaltine. These all come under this malted drinks or malted beverage section. And smoothies. This is a flavored sweetened beverage made by fruit extracts, fruit pulp, fruit peels and crushed ice. As fruit juices are included in this, so this is also a nourishing beverage. Now, on the presentation slide, you can find these three books, Food and Beverages and Food and Beverage Management. These books are printed by Pearson Publications. In fact, the first book on your system, the Food and Beverage F&B Simplified, is written by me and my colleague Mr. Gopi Krishna. So this book is exclusively written for F&B service of NCHMCT. It covers the entire syllabus of all 3 years. It also covers many university syllabus of first year and as well second year. The second book is Beverages. If somebody wants gain more knowledge in beverages, if somebody is looking for a career, a detailed knowledge in beverages part, they can also purchase this book. And this beverages book is more useful to gain in detail knowledge. And later they have a book called Food and Beverage Management by John Cousins, which would be helping for your Food and Beverage Management subject. These three books are available online and as well as in bookstores also in your city. Now we come to alcoholic beverages. As I said earlier, there are two types of beverages. One is non-alcoholic beverages, other one is alcoholic beverages. We already discussed about non-alcoholic beverages. Now we discuss about alcoholic beverages. As I said earlier, any portable beverage, any portable liquid that contains 0.5 to 75% of alcohol by volume, that is known as alcoholic beverage. That means alcoholic percentage or ethanol percentage. Ethanol means ethyl alcohol. That percentage should be between 0.5 to 75. That beverage is known as alcoholic beverage. Let us see the classification of alcoholic beverages now. The alcoholic beverages are classified into two, that is fermented beverages and as well as fermented and distilled beverages. It is classified into two, fermented beverages, fermented and distilled beverages. Fermentation is producing alcohol by the action of yeast. Suppose if you take a sugar containing, a starch containing liquid and a yeast is added to that. So that yeast converts the starch or sugar, soluble sugar, into alcohol and carbon dioxide. That beverage is known as a fermented alcohol beverage. This is a simple definition of a fermentation process. A biochemical process, it is a biochemical process that converts sugar into alcohol and carbon dioxide. For that we may take a grape juice or any other fruit juice or any other starch containing liquid and we have to add yeast to that. So the resultant one is alcohol. So the beverages produced by the method of fermentation are known as fermented alcoholic beverages. On the screen, you can see the slides. So in the fermented alcoholic beverages, there are two categories. One is wine and as well as beer. In the fermented alcoholic beverage section, you have alcoholic percentage less when compared to fermented and distilled alcoholic beverages. In the fermented alcoholic beverages, in case of beer, the alcoholic percentage is 4 to 7 you will be finding, and wine it ranges from 7 to, in case of fortified wines, it would be 7 to 24, that would be the alcoholic percentage. So these are fermented, both are wine and as well as beer are fermented alcoholic beverages. And again, wine is further classified, that we will discuss in the next slide. And beer also is further classified into ale, lager, stout, porter and pilsner. The second category is fermented and distilled alcoholic beverages. Fermented and distilled alcoholic beverages. In the fermented and distilled alcoholic beverages, the major point what one can see is the alcoholic percentage is more in this when compared to fermented alcoholic beverages. After fermentation, it is distilled also. The fermented liquid is distilled to increase the alcoholic percentage. That means if a wine is distilled, automatically brandy is produced. In the wine, alcoholic percentage is, if we assume that is 7 to 14% alcohol by volume, in the brandy it is somewhere around 42 to 45. So alcoholic percentage is increased, am I right? Yes. Alcoholic percentage is increased. This is because of fermentation and distillation procedure. After fermentation, it is distilled. Alcohol is distilled to increase the alcoholic percentage. So this fermented and distilled alcoholic beverages are divided into again three sections. That is aperitifs, liqueurs and spirits. As you all know, the examples for spirits are whiskey, brandy, rum, gin, vodka and tequila. These are all examples for spirits. Aperitifs. These are the alcoholic beverages that are consumed. These are the alcoholic beverages that are consumed before one start his lunch and dinner. They are offered before the meal. So these are like appetizers, but these are beverages. That is why they are called as aperitifs. Good examples for aperitifs are Ricard, Pernod All pasty beverages, that is aniseed or liquorice beverages. These are aperitifs. And the next one is liqueurs. It is a flavored sweetened liquor. The liquor is taken, it is flavored and sweetened. That is called as liqueur. You find the difference between liquor and liqueur. Liquor is spirit, that is whiskey, rum, gin, vodka, brandy and tequila. But a liqueur is entirely different. It is a flavored and sweetened liqueur. That is, suppose if you take Drambuie, D-R-A-M-B-U-I-E, Drambuie, that is a combination of honey and as well whiskey. So a whiskey is taken, it is flavored and sweetened with honey. So that is called as Drambuie. So this is what is liqueur. A liqueur is flavored and sweetened liquor. Have you understood? Yes. Now, my friend and colleague, Mr. Gopi Krishna, will take over this presentation and he will discuss about wine, classification of wines and understanding a wine label. He will make you understand how a person has to read a wine label before presenting it to the guest. Thank you.
Hi, good evening everyone. I'm Gopi Krishna. Senior lecturer in IHM Sri Shakti, Hyderabad. Okay, my friend Mr. Prasad has already briefed you all well and he's kept you engaged for a very long time. So let me take over from here the presentation. I will just talk about a very few things in the presentation. First, let me start with wine. What is wine and why do we talk about wine? Why not any other beverages? Wine is actually a very old alcoholic beverages that is made from grape juice. Wine has got a long history, but today I won't be talking about all that long history. Let me stick to the a small definition first. Wine is an alcoholic beverage that is obtained from a fermented grape juice. When I say grape juice, you may be thinking that the grapes that are available in a fruit market which we eat, can we make wine from it? Yeah, maybe you can make wine from it, but it is not the wine that can be commercially sold or drunk. The wine making grapes are different. There are many varieties. For more varieties and information, you can go to Beverages, F&B Beverages Simplified book, where we have a lot of information on it. Okay. Let us go to the alcoholic percent of the wines is between 10 to 14 usually. That is a normal wine. Why I'm saying a normal wine, a general wine, is that there are many varieties of wines are there. Let me see what are the different wine varieties that we have. Basically, the wine is classified into five varieties. There are five varieties. The first one that I talk is a still wine. But this classification, before I go further, you will have a doubt. Sir, we have a variety of wines is red wine, white wine and rosé wine. It is that classification is by the color. This classification what we are talking now is a classification by the characteristics of the wine. What are these characteristics? Let me talk a little bit about each of these wines. The first one which I'm going to talk about is still wine. Still wines are also known as table wines. It is called basically a still wine because it doesn't have any kind of a carbonation in it. It is a still. Usually the water that we drink, a packaged water, is called as a still water. Because it has got no movement in it, there is no sparkle in it, there is no aeration in it. Similarly, these wines that we are talking as still wines or table wines has got no activity in it. It is just a still wine. Why do we use this? These still wines are usually drunk along with a meal, that is either lunch or dinner. Okay, and there are many varieties of still wines are available in the market, and each of them has got a different characteristics and flavors and aromas, and their body is different. So they all match to individual food variety that we are having. Okay. Wine usually accompanies with the food that we eat. It is rarely drunk on its own. Okay. So these still wines are also called as table wines because they go on your dining table. The next way, and the alcoholic percent of these still wines is again ranges between 10 to 12. 10 to 12 is the alcoholic percentage of table or still wines. Let's go to the second variety of the wines, which are called as sparkling wines. The sparkling, which is actually the name itself describes, it sparkles when you hold it against the light. Why does it sparkle? It sparkles because it has got a CO2, carbon dioxide aeration in the wine. This wine has got a carbon dioxide in it. How did it get into the bottle? How do they make? There are many methods of making sparkling wines. One of the methods is making the wine get its own carbon dioxide into it. Okay. And the other methods are like how you make soda water, that you incorporate, you know, carbon dioxide from a cylinder into the wine, which is not suggestible actually, great wine. But sparkling wines are one of the best example of sparkling wine is the champagne. When do we have it? What is occasion? Sparkling wine can be consumed with any occasion. It can accompany with any course in the meal. That means you can have this sparkling wine starting with your a meal, and you also can end with the dessert or even after that. It suits to every occasion. It suits to every occasion. Champagne is the most and famous sparkling wine in the world. It comes from France. More details are in the book. The next one, what we are talking is fortified wines. The next category in the wines, fortified wines. The fortified wines are those wines which are fortified. What is this, a fortification? Very simple example that I give you. Every day we watch television, many advertisements that come up, with one of them is a fortified drink. Many children would love. These are fortified drinks are called because these are mixed with the milk or hot water and drank like a Boost, Horlicks, Complan. These are all called as a fortified drinks once they are mixed with the milk. What happens once? Why is it called as a fortified drink? Fortification is, you know, literally means you enhance the characteristics or enrich the content. That is what is called as a fortification. When it comes to wine's fortification, the wines are enriched with more alcohol, or their alcoholic percentage is enhanced. These kind of wines are called as a fortified wines. There are again different methods of fortifying a wine. Okay, and sherry and the port wines are the best, you know, examples that I can give you for a fortified wine. There are other things like Malaga, Marsala are also other fortified wines, but you know, world renowned fortified wines are sherry and port. These fortified wines alcoholic content is usually ranges from 18 to 22. It can be up to 22% by the alcohol. Okay, so it itself says that the alcoholic content is more, so they are enhanced with more alcohol. The next category in wines are aromatized wines. Again, the name itself denotes here, these wines are aromatized. These are aromatized with botanical material like herbs, spices, fruits, flowers, roots, tubers. There are many botanical material are used to aromatize the wines. Okay. The one of the best aromatized wines, the world renowned one and mostly used one, is a vermouth. It is used in most of the mixed drinks. Also drunk on its own is vermouth. Other than that, there are many other aromatized wines that are drunk as aperitifs. Okay, these are drunk before a meal because these are, they increase the appetite before you start your meal. So these aromatized wines are usually served before meal, and these alcoholic content is again ranges between 15 to 18% of alcoholic, 15 to 18% alcohol by volume. The next category in the wines is tonic wines. Okay, tonic wines are not very popular in the market because you don't have many manufacturers, and also it is not consumed very often, so you don't see them in the market. What are these tonic wines? Tonic wines are also they are invented or introduced into the market for a medicinal purposes. That is the reason it is actually called as a tonic wine. These are also enhanced with some kind of botanical material, which are enriched with some medicinal properties, drunk when you are not too well. But they are not actually medicines. You don't get them in a medical shop. But these tonic wines are those things when your stomach is upset, when you're not feeling well, your mood is off. That time, these can set you free. These are called as tonic wines. Next, let's go to the next slide here. As I told you before, the wines are also classified by the color. They are basically three varieties: red, white, and rosé. Now, the previous slide shows that there are different varieties. So, in the still wines, you get the still wines in red, white, and rose, all three colors. The second one, sparkling wine. Mostly sparkling wines are white wines because only white wines can be sparkled, and you can't see any sparkles in red wine, though there are hardly any red sparkling wines. But there are some rosé sparkling wines, that is a pink colored sparkling wines. When you go to other wines, for fortified wines, you find both red and white and rosé also. And these, when you come to aromatized wines, again you find red and rosé white also. But tonic wines, there are no limits. Many of them are in dark color because they are infused with botanical material. Okay, now the next slide is different shades of wines. Different shades of wines. When, as you can see on the slide, these are the different shades of white wines, how they look. I got this slide from the net of which I thought it will be interesting to share with you all. Though they are all white wines, the at most right one is a little amber color. It is actually deep amber color. Still we call it a white wine. Why do we call it? How do it become as amber color? It is because of aging process in oak cask. The oak cask imparts some flavor and also the color. The aging timing, how old it is aged in it, also imparts the color into it. We'll come back to the slide once we go to the further two slides, because I need something to correlate there. The next one is the rosé wine shades. Though they are all pink wines, rosé wines, there is a huge difference between one and another. So if you see them individually, you call all of them as rosé wines, but when they are compared together, there is a huge difference. There are some grape varieties that are wrote on top of the glasses: Pinot Noir, Merlot, Grenache, and Malbec. When you use those kind of grape varieties, probably you get this kind of color, but it is not certain that every time you get the same color when you use that wine, grapes. The next slide is the shades of red wine. Here also, you see that there is a little difference between the first glass to the sixth glass, though they are all red wines. Some of them are full-bodied, which are dark in color. Some of them are light-bodied, which are little transparent. Okay. When you see the sixth glass here, and two slides back, the sixth glass here are pretty much similar to the color. Though the first one is a white wine, this is a red wine, you have color contrast. So we need to know actually which are the white wines and red wines. How do we know? Further down the presentation, I would be telling how do we know how to read a label and all. Here you can see a slide that comes in between with the books that are available with the PSN publishers, which are related to hotel management or catering technology or hospitality industry. The first one, as Ms. Prasad already told you, is an author written by us. And the second one comes from Beverages. This is also a very good book. I have myself read and personally recommend that. Then you have Food and Beverage Management, which has actually done a great job there by the author, which will actually suit to many of the syllabuses. The fourth one that you have is the Food Science and Nutrition. I think, as far as my knowledge, that is the only book that is available in India, which suits to the syllabus actually. So that even that is a great book published by the Pearson. Let's go to the next slide. Now here we are. You say it's understanding wine label. I know what is a wine. I see, I serve, I also drink wine. But does it make so much importance, or is it so important to understand a wine label? Yes, it is. Because wine is not just drunk, it is experienced. When you have to experience wine, you need to have some knowledge about wine. Every label on all wine bottles will give information about that particular wine. Wine labels are important sources of information to get you the knowledge about that wine. The best things that a wine can tell is that, the most important 4 points I tell. Let me not complicate you. There are 4 points that are important to know about a wine, is that a grape variety that is used to make that wine, the year when it is produced, and the region or origin from where it is come from, which country or which region it is come from, and the name of the wine, the grape variety, year it has been produced, where it has come from, and the bottler or whatever the brand name of the wine. Other than this, these are very, very important to know first. That is a basic information about any wine. Other than that, the further information, advanced information that you should be reading about a wine is that what flavor, what bouquet do you have, what bodied they are, and which food does it suit to. There are some sweet wines or wine labels that say that this wine is best served along with the desserts. Some wines labels say that this is supposed to be served chilled. Some says that they have instructions, serving instructions also on it. So this is an advanced information that you need to. When you are serving or you are having yourself a wine, when you know this information, the way you enjoy or experience the wine is different. I'll tell you some label terminologies here. What means what? Because most of the wine labels has got these terminologies, imported wines. I know Indian wines has got English terminology, but if you're talking about a good wine, then you find a different terminology. These labels are in a French language or Spanish, Italian or German, basically. Of course, wherever the country it comes from, they write in those and that language. Some basic terms that I will tell you to understand the basic information. Though there are hundreds of terms that are found on a label, which is not possible for me to explain you now. Let's start with one which is says BLANC, blanc, which is pronounced as a blanc, which means white. So to know what wine is it, which color wine is it, blanc, rosé, which is a pink wine, rouge is a red wine. So blanc, rosé, or rouge. These three terms are French terms which will say which colored wine it is. Shato means a wine estate, that means which estate it has been made, it is come from. Sec, yes, is sec is a dry, demi-sec is a medium dry, du is sweet. Du, D-O-U-X, you don't pronounce it as a dux, you pronounce it as a du, which is a sweet. And some or other terms are medium bottle or chateau. Is that it is a bottle at the winery itself. That is wherever it has been produced. It is. Why does it have to say? Usually the wines are not bottled by the winery or wine maker who has actually harvested the grapes and made wine. It is not bottled by them. There are corporations which collect wine from different farmers or wineries. They blend the wine, they bottle it, they label it, and they market it. This is how the wine industry runs. But these are particular wines which says on the label as a Maison, bottle or chateau are those wines which are bottled at the winemaker itself. It is not sold to third party and then it. Trocken, the next term is trocken, is a dry in the German language. Sekt is a sparkling wine in German language. Spumante is a sparkling wine in Italian language. Tinto is red in Spanish. Rosado is a rose and pink wine in Spanish. Now, I have a label here. It's a sample label scanned from one of the wine bottles. Okay. Now, which has got a different, labeled given on it, what how a wine label is. Every time you don't find this wine labels very clearly written on that. That means they won't say from which origin it is coming from, which year it is produced, whatever. They are all printed on the label. It is up to us how do we find it. How do we find the information? This particular label is a French label, French wine label. It has got where it is come from, which grape it is come from. It says Bourgogne Pinot Noir. Pinot Noir is a grape variety. Bourgogne is a region. It also says it's 75 centiliters, which is a bottle capacity. Alcoholic content of the wine is 212.5. It has got manufacturer or a bottler's address and its information. It also has got a logo of it, and it also says which appellation the origin of Controle is, what the quality, the grade of the wine, which grade. This particular grade is the highest grade in French wines. That means this is exceptionally good quality wine. When you know this, then only you can say or suggest to somebody that whether this wine is good or not. The next one is German. It's a German label. Again, it has all the information in a small label. If you can see that how so many things are written all around it. It name and address of the producer you have. Moselle Sarreur is a origin or region from where it is coming. You have alcoholic content here, 10% by volume. You have a quality classification here, Qualitätswerte Pratica. That means this is the highest grade, the best quality wine that Germany can produce. Okay, and what kind of making? The grape variety is a Riesling year. Which year it has been produced? This is 1988, which is a vintage year. And you also have Riesling is a grape variety, which I have already mentioned. The Spazel Strocken is the way how it, the production method, how the grapes are, when they are harvested and how they are. There are 6 methods in Germany to give this classification. And this is one of the category. The next label is, it says again, the brand name is Grimaldi. And the vintage year is 1990, and it is a Riserva. This is an Italian label, sir. Italian wine label. It again says 750 ml is the bottle quantity in that content, and the address of the manufacturer. Alcoholic content is 13%, and you again have the quality term here. This is denominates the controlata, a guarantita. This is the wine category, one of the good highest grade of wine. So it's exceptionally good quality from Italy. Then you have a Spanish wine label. The Spanish label. You have a name of the company here. You have a Rioja, which is a region there. And this is the name of the wine. The vintage year 1989. And the quality that you have is highest quality grade that you have is given here. And name and address of the winery, where it has been bottled, who made it, etc. You again have a quantity or volume of the wine. And this alcoholic percentage, and you have an official seal. If you see that it's a small label, but it gives a tremendous amount of information. This is only one side of the label. Now all the bottles have got the back side bottle, that is back side of the label. Still, it gives further information in which you will have what bouquet it has got, what kind of wine, what flavors do you have in the wine, what a blend is it. All these extra advanced information is given at the back side of the label. So if you have a bottle in your hand, it is a, and you know how to read a label, it as good as that you will tell everything, the history and the knowledge about the wine. Okay, it's just that you need to know how to use it. So there are beverages is a vast subject. Okay, the wines is the only tiny thing in it. There are many other beverages in the wines also. We just talked about label reading and other and different categories. Now it is not possible to take a class in a marathon level now for all the beverages. Let me just brief you about why do we have to learn about beverages? What is the scope? What do we where can we land after reading this or studying this beverages? There are a few fancy, I can say, and they are showman skills actually. These jobs are very, very skillful jobs, and the beverages still we don't have that much of competition in this sector where people fight for jobs. There are many, many vacancies when you study beverages. Some of the jobs that you can get, or areas where you can be posted, you can be a bartender. We all know how bartenders are in 5-star hotels or deluxe hotels and all. They are very skillful. People do juggling, they do flaring, it is a skillful job. When you have a skill in your hand, when you learn that, when you know the beverage knowledge, you are the king of your area. So this is one of that. And the next one is sommeliers. Sommeliers are those people who have got extensive knowledge about wines. Okay, they are not just a beverage people. Along with that, they will have extensive knowledge about wines. These are recruited by many, many hotels or groups of hotels to buy wines for their chain or group of hotels. What these sommeliers' job is to sit and check which are the best brands, which are the good quality wines that they can project in their group of hotels, and they will just suggest those things, and managements will buy those things and put in there. It's a very, very skillful job again. But sommeliers also do good in abroad, that is in European and Western countries, because the wine culture is more there. Then you have beverage managers. This is another designation that you find in any star hotel, that these managers are the in charge for all kind of beverage sales or purchases and operations. So there's only one beverage manager in the hotel. Then wine appreciates. These are the people who are actually into wine industry. But all wineries will recruit such kind of people to test and taste their wine quality and to blend their wines. The wine appreciates, and also these people take different classes for wineries. So they will have some seminars conducted to get awareness about wines in the market. So this is also a highly appreciated job. The bartending schools, you can open your own bartending school. Nowadays, it's a good coming up trend, though there are many schools in that, but still coming up. It's just started. I think every state has got 3-4 bartending schools, not more than that. When you see actually how many people they can get careers into that, these bartending schools are nothing, but you require much more to be established. So if you have a beverage knowledge, then you can have a bartending school open for you. Mixology. And mixologists are those people who knows about the cocktails, okay, and which ingredient goes well with what best cocktail can be made. Licensed event management. These are the event management companies who open extensively for the beverage service. So these are licensed events. So they deal completely with the beverages and the events. Then you have a beverage technologist. Like food technology people, you also have a beverage technology people who will be getting or testing, checking the beverages, and they also see the technology. They have a lab. They will check the beverage content. They will improve the quality. They will improve the flavor of the beverage. So they find invent new flavors. Okay, they are called the beverage technologists. Okay, these people are also, though it is not an open market and not many people are available now, but it is also upcoming job careers that people can take up to these things. So many beverage industries are looking for beverage technologists, so that they wanted to introduce new flavors. For example, you have flavored vodkas, different flavored rums. All these are invented or introduced by beverage technologists. This is about the careers that you can have by studying beverages. And the next slide is again, we just want to see, look at the slide, and you have some books that are available with the Pearson publishers. They are all can be bought online and are also available in the market. I would be expecting some questions from you all so that I can answer. If you would like to speak to Mr. Prasad, he is also here. But anyways, I can answer your questions, or I can call Mr. Prasad to answer your questions. Sometime back, somebody called as Vishal Adho as posted here saying that, sir, I have some questions. If he can type what is his question, then I can answer. Vishal Adho. It's Vishal Adho, are you there? Vishal says that what is tonic? He wants to know about a tonic. What is a tonic? Yeah. Tonic is tonic is a name given to a beverage or a drink that has got a medicinal purpose. It has got a medicinal purpose or property to it. These tonics are made, they are, as I said, medicinal purpose. They are to do with something with your health improvement. So they are usually made with botanical material or different parts of the plant. The infused or extracts of those are added into alcohol for better preservation and better effect. These are called as tonics. Now, the same term is till now we use all for all the medicines, whatever the tonic that you get from medical shop or your cough syrup or kind of thing, they're also called as tonics now, because it is, even it is a you know, a medicinal property, medicinal you know, this thing, that is what is called a tonic. There are different materials that are infused into your this tonics. As is Mr. Prasad said previously, quinine is one of that, which will release stress, releases, and it deoxidizes the system. And there are many other things which refreshes or distresses the nervous system. They're all called as tonics. I believe, Mr. Vishal, I clear your doubt. I answered that. I would be expecting more questions. Okay, here is another question. Yeah, somebody posts saying that, sir, where do we, which occasion is the right occasion to serve sparkling wine? And he says that what is the champagne? My dear, this champagne is nothing but a sparkling wine, but the champagne is especially made in France, a particular region called as a champagne. The Champagne is a small region, a small area in France. Any sparkling wine that is produced in that area and sold out is called as a champagne. It is not just area, but it is actually, you know, the method they use there. That is what makes it so special and unique. The sparkling wine that comes from this region is unique or special for the method they use, and of course the climate, the grapes that they use, they all make a lot of difference. That's the reason it is that's the reason champagne is so special. It is nothing but a sparkling wine that comes from France. When can you serve? Yeah, there is no particular occasion or time to serve, you know, a champagne. As I told you previously, champagne suits to every occasion. Let it be a wedding, let it be a candlelight dinner, let it be a birthday party, or let it be any other celebration, champagne goes with it. And champagne can be matched with most of the courses in the meal. So there are no limits for it, except that you don't like an aerated drink. You can have a sparkling wine anytime. And where... Okay, that's it. Here is another question who asked that, what temperature do we serve this wine? What temperature do we serve wines? Different wines are served at different temperatures. Let me start with the red wine. Red wine is served at room temperature. That is what everybody says, but it is not a room temperature of a tropical country. It is room temperature of European countries, which is 18 degrees centigrade. So red wines supposed to be served at 18 degrees centigrade. Yeah, that is the right temperature where you can have best bouquet of a red wine. And white wines are served at 12 degrees centigrade. White wines are served at 10 to 12 degrees centigrade is what the right temperature to serve. They are supposed to be served chilled. The white wines taste better when they are served chilled. And sparkling wine is little less than white wines, which is 8 degrees centigrade. 8 degrees centigrade is the right temperature to serve a sparkling wine. And fortified and aromatized wines are served according to the instructions given on them, because there are different ones served different temperatures. Here is another question which says the types of beer, sir. Though I cannot explain all the types of beers here, this is Mr. Krishna. Basically, the beers are categorized by the malt level that you have in it and also the fermentation process that you have. Basically, Mr. Krishna, the beers are lager beers or ale beers. Lager or ale beers. So, lager beers are many are there again, and that are subcategories. Ale beers are many are there. The ale beers are top fermented beers. They are top fermented. That means the fermentation process happens on top of the fermentation tank. The yeast floats on top of the wort and it ferments. This lager beers, the yeast settles down to the bottom of the fermentation tank and the process happens there, process of fermentation process. The major difference that you can see is that these lager beers are fermented in a slow and cold temperatures, and ale beers are at a high in a little higher temperature, that is at 40 to 45 degrees centigrade, and they are top fermented and it is they're fast fermented. Krishna, I believe I have answered your question. Can I take a last question, please? Because the session ends in a couple of minutes. So, if anybody can give me a last question, I'll answer that. There is somebody called Mrs. Mahajan here on the line. Red wine is served at room temperature in France, but in India the room temperature is high. So how do we serve red wine in India? Mrs. Mahajan, I just answered 2 minutes back that red wine, the right temperature, if you go by the figures, 18 degrees centigrade. So the room temperature, don't go by Indian or tropical country room temperature, it is a European room temperature. So it is 18 degrees centigrade. I think I made myself clear there. You're welcome. Thank you very much. Here we come to an end of this webinar session. Thank you very much all the listeners and asking your questions and support. Thank you.